We're at Techland, the new partner for An Exile, and we're talking to Brian Fargo. And what else are we going to talk about but Torment, of course.
Of course.
So we've seen a presentation, and you've made a few announcements this month, and one of them is it's going to be on Xbox One, and going to be on PS4. And first I thought, is that not going to be a lot of work? But we've already seen it now on Xbox One. How far were you along when you announced it?
Well, we had always kind of secretly wanted to do it, but we weren't sure. And so when we took Wasteland 2 and we put it onto console, we ended up doing a lot of the work because we're using the same engine. Yeah. So a lot of the heavy lifting had already been done. And the response has been great because we have some of our backers who have said, you know, the minimum specs is quite high for the PC version of Torment. And so that they weren't sure if they were going to be able to meet those specs. So now, on a PlayStation and Xbox, they can go ahead and do it. So really, it wasn't that difficult. And we developed two user interfaces. We have a radial interface for console, and then we have the traditional one on PC. So it wasn't that bad, and we knew people would be very excited about it.
Okay. And we've already seen a lot about how you took the Numenera system and ported it into a PC game. But one thing I'm really curious about still is the tides. We've seen in the beta that tides change and things like that.
Right.
But how much impact is that going to have?
Well, the tides is a very subtle system. You know, one of the things that we like to do with our role-playing games is we put a tremendous amount of detail in, some of which people will never see or they'll only slightly feel. And of course, if you do a replay, you get a real sense of it. And the tides very much fall under that, which is you'll see a lot of choice and a lot of consequence based upon how you behaved during the world. Whether are you more lawful or lawless, right? You know, are you benevolent? You know, what is your attitude? And so these will affect the ties. And so you'll see things you wouldn't otherwise see, and you'll have options even in conversations you wouldn't otherwise have. So it's a really subtle system with the tides, but I think that anybody that really throws themselves into the world is going to really appreciate it.
Okay. And how close is the relationship between the Numenera setting and now Torment? At first you chose Sagas Cliffs, which is not in the core book, but now there's a guide out there, and I've seen something like Little Neelish, which is a callback to the core book. Right. How close is the work between you and Monty Cook Games?
Well, we've been in sync with Monty since the very beginning. And even when we want to do some things outside the core book, you know, we run everything by Monty to make sure he's okay with it.
Okay.
And, I mean, the great thing about the Numenera universe, it's so strange. We can do anything we want with it. And I think that's part of the appeal, too. You know, I think one of the things that resonated with Planescape Torment was it wasn't your typical sci-fi. It was something completely different. You know, it wasn't high fantasy, and this clearly isn't quite science fiction. It's just this strangeness, and it's the quality of the writing, and I think that's what people are loving about what they're playing here. It's just not like anything else, I was thinking about this on the way over today, you know, how many more of these type of games will even get made? I mean, this could be the last of an era. These sort of mega single player narrative games, there's not that many in development. I don't even know if any are after this of this kind of size, and so they are a lot of effort, so it could be one of the last.
Yeah, but Torment is very successful. Even after the Kickstarter, you raised a lot more money. You've got a great partner with Techland.
Yes, yes.
So maybe you're the stepping stone. Is that something you're hoping for, that other people are going to see this work still?
Well, I guess I don't think so much about what other people may or may not do. I'm really kind of focused on what we might do, and these things are a lot of effort. It's been like four years, and people have been frustrated that we've been late, but they'll remember a good title forever, and if it's not a good, then they'll remember that forever too. So we have to really nail it. So we wanted to spend the time to do it right. But for us, it's a real writer's project. These large games. You know, I always quote people. I tell them, you know, we have more words than the Bible. I mean, you think of that as a thick book, right? More than War and Peace. And so, and we've got to have all these parts all talking to each other and people understanding. And it actually becomes, the game is so big such that even the lead designers don't know everything that's in the title. Like, no one person can know it all, almost.
Okay. Do you know how much you can even see in one playthrough of those more than a million words, actually?
That's a great question. I've been asking kind of the same thing, which is, you know, what percentage of the content can you possibly see in one playthrough? And I wouldn't imagine it's more than 60% or so.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you know how much time it's going to clock in for a full playthrough?
You know, every time I take a guess, it ends up being longer than I thought. I mean, even the early access that we put out, which is just, you know, maybe a third of the game, people are clocking in 25 hours on that. And so, you know, that it's a minimum of 50 to 60 hours, it feels, not counting replayability. And we always design our games, like, we're always trying to push what it means to be a role-playing game. And one of the things, obviously, is meaningful choice and consequence. It can't be where the same two decisions end up the same place every time or affect the story. And so we end up creating a tremendous amount of writing that we know people will never see on a single playthrough.
We've already talked about the strangeness or the weirdness, and I get kind of the feeling that you even dialed it up a notch from the original setting, because there's so many strange things, and even in the beta, you hardly see anything that's normal, kind of. Right. Did you just tell your designers, run wild with it, do anything you like?
Well, I did kind of give an edict of the stranger, the better. Let's just say there won't be any quests where you're having to collect 10 rabbit pelts, right? Everything, you know, you might be collecting eyeballs for a guy to see again or something strange like that, but it's not going to be, I don't think we do any trope whatsoever.
Okay, great. So in the end, it's been a great work. It's been a lot of work, a huge team. Would you do it again?
You know, you can't ask me that now. I'm exhausted having gone through this one. Everybody is very anxious to get this thing wrapped up. Like I said, these things are, you know, people think that because I've been doing games for a long time that there'll be all these lessons that apply to the next one. And so why doesn't it get easier? Why aren't these things on time? Why are they always late? And that because every single time I do a project, it's 50% plus of the things we're working on are brand new that we've never had to deal with, issues we've never dealt with before. And that's if you're going to be a creator and you're going to be trying to break new ground, it comes with the territory. Now, if I'm going to do a straight derivative port of something or do a sequel where it's just a simple add-on, that's a different conversation, right? But if we're going to do something innovative, we're going to be, you know, we're going to be having to sort of reinvent a wheel in many ways. And you're dealing with new people, new personnel, and everything about it. I mean, development's pretty tricky. And I always say it's really fun to start games, but really hard to finish them. And so thank God we're in the final stretch.
Okay, so last question now is, you've said from the start, this is not going to be about DLCs, this is going to be a finished game when you give it out to our backers, but if people are clamoring for, say, a second part or for an add-on, is there a no for you or a maybe?
For a DLC?
Not for a DLC, but for a real add-on. Like in the good old times when an add-on was really kind of a second game.
I don't know. Like I said, it's such a tight story. That, I mean, you can always do an add-on. It would have to be something else, some kind of sort of adventure, right? We're telling a very specific tale here. And so just to add something onto that wouldn't quite feel right. But it's not to say that we couldn't possibly do something like that. Okay. There is nothing in the works for that. And again, I think everybody needs to just, you know, after 4 years of writing, you know, creatively, you want to sort of get your brain and give it a rest and think about something else.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm very much looking forward to the finished version.
Thank you.
Okay, so now we're going to talk to Cormac Coombe. You're the lead storyteller for Torment: Tides of Numenera, and you're also kind of a brother in arms with Monty Cook, having worked on Planescape setting.
Yeah, that's correct. I've known Monty for, 25 years now.
Okay, so I guess a lot of the connection between In Exile and between Monty Cook Games, that was you, basically.
It was. I'll take credit for that. But you know, I've been really fortunate to meet some really cool people. So I'm grateful for the opportunity.
Okay. As lead storyteller, I guess you've got a huge team that has churned out more than a million words to complete this game. How many people are actually working it? How many writers?
Boy, we got a whole lot of writers for the Kickstarter, but we wound up with a core team of about four or five.
Okay.
Myself, Gavin Jurgens-Fury, Leanne Taylor, Mark Yahalem, and Adam Heine. And then our lead area designer, George Zeitz, also helped as well.
Okay. The basic idea, what kind of story you were going to tell with the last cast of searching for a way to kind of get out of this deal that she's going to be, or he's going to be killed. Where did the idea come from? Was that someone that you came up, something you came up with, or was that a basic idea that was there before you came in?
No, I've actually been here from the very start. So it was Adam Heine and myself and our old producer Kevin Saunders. We hashed this out together. We decided that we wanted to talk about legacy, the choices that we make and what we leave behind, and even whether that makes any difference. When you are talking about a world that's a billion years in the future, I mean, all of our history is gone by that point. You know, and so what do our actions mean when compared against the vast span of the universe? And we wanted to address, you know, how people approach that in many different ways.
Okay. So we've seen a lot of weirdness already in the beta and in the presentation you did. And I've also seen callbacks to the core book, like Little Nilish, with Nilish being a place in the core book. Mm-hmm. So was it important to you to have these kind of links back to the book?
Absolutely. We didn't want to be like, okay, we've got the Numenera setting, but we're not doing anything with it. We wanted to make sure that people who played the Numenera campaign setting would feel at home in our world.
And you've also, now there's also out the campaign guide for the Sagas Cliffs, working right. with Shauna Germain.
Correct, yeah. Shauna's great. I love her.
Okay. When writing, have you ever had kind of the point where you said, I want to do this this idea, and someone said, no, that's too weird?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. It's I come up with a lot of crazy ideas, though, so sometimes they have to rein me in.
Okay, anything that comes to mind, we've seen you can feed your companions to a huge creature to open a portal or thing. Were those kind of worse? I mean on a moral level.
On a moral level, I don't know about that necessarily. I think it was really more about an implementation level. I don't think we can actually show... I'm sorry, I'm going to spoil the story. I don't want to. Yeah,
there's things where kind of the game engine cannot do what you want to tell.
Correct. Yeah, there were things that were just impossible with the technology we've got, and also things that probably would have broken the story preemptively. So we had to fix those pretty quickly.
Okay. And I've already asked Brian, but he could only kind of estimate, make a guess, and I think you're the guy to ask, how much can I actually see in one playthrough, depending on the characters that I have?
Maybe 50%.
Maybe 50%.
Maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a really tough one. I mean, there's going to be all sorts of different things that your companions open up for you, and all sorts of things that maybe 30%.
Okay.
Yeah, boy, I don't know. That's a really tough question. I don't think we've ever actually figured that out.
Wow, and it means you have to play it at least twice to see it, and maybe three times.
Absolutely. Every quest has multiple resolutions, and all of those feed into different things as well. So you're going to be missing a lot of content every time you play.
How often did you lose kind of sight of something and then had to figure out how everything is connected?
Frequently. We documented this game extensively just so we'd be like, okay, but what about, I don't know, and have to go back to it. Yeah, no, our team is brilliant. I am really thrilled to be working with these guys. They're honestly one of the best teams I've ever worked with.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm very much looking forward to the finished game, and I hope you can take a long time off when it's done.
I can't take too much time off. What will I do with my time?
Be creative. Any idea what's going to be next?
Yes, but I can't talk about it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate your time.